Hello everyone. In this lecture video, I'll be talking about sulfur cycle. Biogeochemical cycle mainly refers to the movement of nutrients and other elements between biotic and abiotic factors. Means here in this cycle, there is a continuous recycling of nutrients through air, water, rock, soil and living organism. Means it based on the fact that no new molecules are created. What we have is what was here at the beginning. Now, as we are going to study about the sulfur cycle, so we should know what is the role of sulfur in living world. Where do we find this sulfur? Sulfur is an essential component of proteins. Basically, proteins are made up of amino acids. It is nothing but the chain of amino acids. Okay, now there are two amino acids, namely cysteine and methionine, which contains sulfur. And therefore, these amino acids are important from a protein synthesis point of view, and thus the sulfur is essential for the life. An average cell may have approximately 1% of sulfur by dry weight. This is the sulfur cycle. Basically, this sulfur cycle is divided into four steps. Number one stage, that is nothing but the decomposition of organic compound. Okay, now let's begin with the sulfate. Sulfate is the form of sulfur which is mainly utilized by many of the plants and bacteria. You can see over here, sulfate is utilized by plant as well as bacteria, and it is get converted, or that sulfur is used for biosynthesis of organic compound. Biosynthesis of organic compound means that sulfate is used for the synthesis of protein. Okay, this is known as the assimilation of sulfate by plant and bacteria. Further, after the death of plant or the bacteria or the living organisms, rather we say, that dead body get deposited in the soil, and again the microbes comes in the picture and they carry out the decomposition of this organic compound, and it results in production of H2S, that is hydrogen sulfide. Now, whatever the hydrogen sulfide which is produced, further this hydrogen sulfide is get oxidized by the different bacteria, different microorganism. Now this oxidation of sulfide takes place in two different situations. One, in presence of oxygen, so we call it as a aerobic oxidation of hydrogen sulfide, and second one is another group of microorganisms which involves for the oxidation of hydrogen sulfide, but that takes place in anaerobic condition. Okay, so here the purple and green phototrophic bacteria plays important role for conversion of hydrogen sulfides into sulfate, whereas over here in presence of oxygen, the Bagyetoa and Thiobacillus, these two organisms, they mainly involve for oxidation of hydrogen sulfide into sulfate. Again, as I said, this is about the oxidation. The sulfate can be reduced directly into the hydrogen sulfide by desulfo vibrio. Okay, so this is about the sulfur cycling. Now let's study in detail about each step. The essential steps of sulfur cycle. First one is mineralization of organic sulfur to the inorganic form, that is hydrogen sulfide, means decomposition of organic sulfur into inorganic form. The second step is oxidation of hydrogen sulfide and elemental sulfur and related compounds to sulfate. Third step is reduction of sulfate to sulfide. Fourth one is microbial immobilization of sulfur compounds and subsequent incorporation into the organic form of sulfur. So these are four different steps of sulfur cycle which I have already discussed in that diagram. Now let's study in detail about each. First one is the mineralization of organic sulfur to inorganic form or decomposition of organic compound. Whatever the organic compound which is present in the living cell, like as I said, the protein, it contains the sulfur containing amino acids. So the degradation of protein takes place, which results in production of amino acids, and the further decomposition, it results into production of hydrogen sulfide. Now the second step is oxidation of hydrogen sulfide to elemental sulfur. As I mentioned, that oxidation of hydrogen sulfide to elemental sulfur takes place by two ways. One is aerobically and the second one is anaerobically. Now this is about the aerobic oxidation of hydrogen sulfide. Sulfur oxidation, it involves the oxidation of reduced sulfur compounds like hydrogen sulfide or inorganic sulfur and the thiosulfate, which further oxidation, which on oxidation it results into production of sulfuric acids. Now the main organisms which involves in the aerobic oxidation of hydrogen sulfides, these are Bacteria and Thiobacillus. These organisms are mainly found in the habitat that have high level of hydrogen sulfides, and these environments include the coal seeps, sulfur spring, the sewage contaminated water, mud layers of lakes, etc. Now this is the reaction, chemical reaction, what exactly happens in oxidation of hydrogen sulfide. So this is the hydrogen sulfide which reacts with oxygen and get converted into elemental sulfur. Now further it undergoes oxidation and, as I said, it get converted into thiosulfate and into H2SO4. Oxidation of elemental sulfur. Elemental sulfur present in soil cannot be utilized directly by the plants, and therefore it will get converted into the sulfate by chemolithotropic bacteria. So further oxidation of elemental sulfur takes place, and that is carried out by the chemolithotropic bacteria. Example, I have already mentioned Bacteria and Thiobacillus. They are responsible for the further oxidation of elemental sulfur into sulfate. Now the second part of oxidation of hydrogen sulfide, anaerobic oxidation of hydrogen sulfide, because as I said that the oxidation of hydrogen sulfide takes place by two ways, either the aerobically or anaerobically. Now let's focus on the anaerobic oxidation of hydrogen sulfide. The unique characteristics of phototrophic purple and green sulfur bacteria, as well as the membrane of purple non-sulfur bacteria, is their ability to oxidize hydrogen sulfide to sulfate under anaerobic condition in the course of their anoxygenic photosynthesis. Let me tell you about this bacteria. These group of bacteria, they are capable of carrying out the photosynthesis process, but in usual photosynthesis, what happens that the bacteria utilizes the H2 and during the carbon dioxide fixation. But here this bacteria, they utilizes the H2S for the photosynthesis. Okay. Now the cyanobacteria carry out the oxygenic photosynthesis with water. That is what I said, that the normal photosynthesis which is carried out by cyanobacteria, for that they uses water. And on the contrary, the sulfur bacteria, they carry out the photosynthesis but in absence of oxygen. I mean they, in absence of oxygen, in the sense this photosynthesis does not result in production of oxygen. They carry out the unoxygenic photosynthesis where they use the H2S rather than the water molecule. So the purple sulfur bacteria are group of proteobacteria which are capable of photosynthesis, and these bacteria are anaerobic or aerophilic in nature, and they are mainly present in the hot spring or stagnant water. Unlike plants, algae and cyanobacteria, these bacteria do not use water as their reducing agent, and therefore they are not capable of producing oxygen. They don't produce oxygen during photosynthesis because instead of water they use hydrogen sulfide, and this hydrogen sulfide it get oxidized and it produces the granules of elemental sulfur, which may further get oxidized to form the sulfuric acid. So this is about the anaerobic oxidation of hydrogen sulfide. Again, I would like to tell you the summary about this anaerobic oxidation of hydrogen sulfide that is carried out by the purple sulfur bacteria. And these purple sulfur bacteria, they are capable of photosynthesis. Only difference is that these bacteria do not use water for photosynthesis. Rather than water, they use the other reducing agent, and that is they use H2S. And because of this, these bacteria, that is the purple sulfur bacteria, whenever they carry out the photosynthesis, and that time they use the hydrogen sulfide, and therefore this hydrogen, during the photosynthesis process, this hydrogen sulfide get oxidized and it produces the granules of elemental sulfur, which again undergo the oxidation and it results in production of sulfuric acid. Now the next step of sulfur cycle, that is the reduction of sulfate. Now this, again, there are two types of reduction. One is the assimilatory reduction and the second one is the dissimilatory reduction. Now what is assimilatory reduction here? The reduction of sulfate for use in the amino acids and protein biosynthesis, it is called as the assimilatory reduction process. Means what? Whatever the sulfate which is available, that is utilized by the living organism, and that sulfate is used for the synthesis of amino acid. It is used for the biosynthesis of amino acid, and ultimately those amino acids are used in the protein synthesis. So this is known as the assimilatory reduction process. Now the second way, that is the dissimilatory reduction. Here, this use of sulfate as an external electron acceptor to form the sulfide, which accumulates in the environment and is an example of dissimilatory reduction process and the anaerobic respiration. Here, whatever the sulfate which is available, that sulfate is used as a electron acceptor and it undergo reduction and it results in the production of hydrogen sulfide. So this type of reduction of sulfate is known as the dissimilatory reduction. Here the end product of dissimilatory reduction is the production of hydrogen sulfide, whereas the end product of assimilatory reduction is the organic compound, that is protein. Now reduction of sulfate, as I explained, assimilatory as well as dissimilatory. Now let's see over here the dissimilatory reduction of sulfate. The sulfate are reduced to, in dissimilatory, as I said, that the end product is hydrogen sulfide. So sulfate are reduced to hydrogen sulfide by desulfovibrio. Now This reduction, it takes place in two steps. The sulfates are converted to sulfite. The difference between sulfate and sulfite is here SO4 is there and sulfite SO3. And for this conversion, of course, energy is required, and that is provided in the form of ATP. Now the next step is this sulfite further get reduced to hydrogen sulfide. Okay, now the sulfate reducing bacteria can perform the anaerobic respiration utilizing sulfate as a terminal electron acceptor. In aerobic respiration, what happened that the oxygen is used as a terminal electron acceptor, okay, and the water molecule is produced. Because when the oxygen is used as a terminal electron acceptor, this undergo reduction and it results in the production of H2O. But here in sulfate reducing bacteria, now what they do, they carry out the anaerobic respiration. Anaerobic respiration means instead of oxygen, they use sulfate as a terminal electron acceptor. And as they accept this electron, therefore it undergo the reduction and it results in the production of hydrogen sulfide. Thus these bacteria, that is the sulfate reducing microorganism, they breathe sulfate rather than the molecular oxygen, which is the terminal electron acceptor and which results in production of H2O in aerobic respiration. Here I have tried to tell you the difference between the aerobic respiration and the anaerobic respiration, which is carried out by the sulfate reducing bacteria. Now the sulfur reducing bacteria, that is SRB, they get their energy by reducing the elemental sulfur to hydrogen sulfide. See, some bacteria, they can use the elemental sulfur and sulfate as an electron acceptor. Means here, as I said, that sulfate is used as an electron acceptor, but there are some bacteria which instead of using the sulfate, they can use elemental sulfur as an electron acceptor. Even this, whenever the elemental sulfur is used as a last electron acceptor, that further undergo the reduction and get converted into the H2S. This is all about the dissimilatory reduction of sulfate. Now the next step of sulfur cycle is immobilization. Immobilization means what? It is simply the conversion of inorganic compound into organic compound. Here the sulfate is used by the microorganism for the synthesis of amino acids and proteins. So this is known as the immobilization. Now, minor compounds in the sulfur cycle plays major role in biology. An excellent example is dimethyl dimethyl sulfonylpropionate, DMSP, which is used by the bacterioplankton as a sulfur source for protein synthesis and which is transformed into the dimethyl sulfide. It is the volatile sulfur form that can affect the atmospheric. Now, these are some important terminology which we have used in this sulfur cycle. Number one is the unoxygenic photosynthesis. Means what? It is the process that does not involve the production of oxygen. See, there is a difference between unoxygenic and anaerobic. Unoxygenic means what? This is the process which does not result in production of oxygen. Okay, next is photosynthesis. Actually, we all are aware of this, but still I'll just cover it. The process by which plant and other autotrophs, they generate the carbohydrate and oxygen from carbon dioxide, water and light energy in the chloroplast. Next is photoautotrophs. An organism such as all the green plants, that and the bacteria like cyanobacteria that can synthesize its own food from inorganic material using light as a source of energy.